morning, ladies and gentlemen. This is a very special session for us because we have these three outstanding women officers representing each of the three services, the Army, the Navy, the Air Force, and all of them are trailblazers in their chosen careers. So let me quickly run the introductions. To my right is Colonel Neha Singh. She's one of the first women officers in the Army in a command role. So she's commanding an air defense unit along the Indo-Pakistan border in Rajasthan. And we'll talk more about it as we move along. To her right is Commander, Lieutenant Commander Annu Prakash, who is one of the first women in the Navy to be serving on board a warship, a frontline destroyer, INS Kochi. She has just come back from a sea sortie in the Arabian Sea and flown straight from Kochi to Delhi to be here with us for the session. And to her right is Group Captain Shaliza Dhami. She is the first woman in the Air Force in a command role. She's heading a missile squadron in Punjab along the India-Pakistan border. A round of applause for them, please. So the roles they are currently filling were traditionally held by their male counterparts. It is for the first time they are in these roles. And in the next 30 minutes or so, we'll try to capture a 30-year journey and, you know, how things have changed in these 30 years and how they have landed where they've landed. So it all began in the early 90s when the armed forces opened their doors to women for the first time. And these were in limited roles for a limited period of time and in limited streams. That's no longer the case. And a lot of things have changed between then and now. And these three outstanding officers symbolize that change, that transformation. So now we have women flying fighter planes, serving on board warships. They're joining the National Defense Academy, which was a male preserve for almost seven decades. They're joining the non-officer cadre for the first time, and so many other things are happening. So truly a watershed in the history of the armed forces, and as far as gender integration is concerned. So the journey has been from walk to trot, from trot to canter, and canter to full gallop mode now. So we'll cut to the chase and I'll throw some questions at you because the audience is really excited about this session. My first question is to Colonel Neha. Neha, you know, a lot of steps have been taken to advance gender equality. What do you think was the turning point for women in the military?
Well, you know, as far as the turning point for women in Army is concerned, the recent permanent commission that has been granted to women officers, and followed by that, the command roles that have come up, you know, the promotions that have come up. You know, we, when we join Indian Army as an officer, every officer has a dream of someday, one day becoming a commanding officer. So we also had this dream in our mind, but we never knew that it is going to, you know, manifest within our service life, and it has happened. So definitely, this is the turning point.
Totally agree, because if you didn't have permanent commission, there was no question of women being put in command role. Commander Prakash, what I want to ask you is, when did you think we hit the sweet spot? You know, women were deployed on warships for a very brief time in the late 90s, a very short-lived experiment on two ships, just a couple of women officers. But now the numbers are increasing and you are one amongst the 40 women officers who are today serving on frontline warships. So what, according to you, is you know, the point at which things changed?
Thank you, Rahul, for the question. It is actually a very question very close to my heart, because I am serving on board a warship, one amongst the few lady officers first got posted on board the ship. Navy, amongst the three forces was the first one to induct women officers. And thereafter, the numbers have just increased. I think in the year 2008 was an operational field open to the women, wherein the women were inducted in naval air operation as in naval air operation officers. That was the operation role for a woman, and I am one amongst them. And thereafter, in 2016, the women got inducted as pilot. And the turning point is definitely the women being appointed on board a warship. With that, the numbers are going to increase with women Agniveers.
I'll come to that later. Shaliza, what I want to ask you is, things were a slow burner for years, you know, 1992, 93, this whole thing started and then picked up pace only in the decade of 2010s. So what do you think changed in those years?
See, anytime we induct something new, we go systematically. So probably when the women officers were inducted in 1992 or 93, early 90s, which we talked, there was a system placed for certain branches, which you have already mentioned. But later, when women were employed on other branches, today I can say that in Indian Air Force, all branches of Indian Air Force are open to women officers, right? You name any branch, women officer is there. And I will not say that there was one turning point. If you talk about only the flying branch, there were a couple of turning points. If I put it sequentially, in 2013, when the first time service decided that we'll be sending a women flyer to undergo qualified flying instructor course, which is a very, you know, prestigious course in itself, that was a turning point for all the flyers. And subsequently, after doing that course, employing that women officer for that instructional role, giving permanent commission to flying branch. Other branches did have the permanent commission, but flying branch was inducted a little later. So getting a permanent commission for the first time. Subsequently, employing women officer for flight commander of a flying unit. For everybody's understanding, a flight commander is number two in the seniority in a unit, who is responsible for planning, conducting, coordinating all the flying activities of a flying squadron. It's a responsible job. And next to it is promoting to the group captain select rank in the flying branch, giving the command role of a combat squadron.
Right.
Is there. And I think I am honored that in whatever the milestones were, whatever the, you know, turning points were there, I was the first one to do that. So that gave me a satisfaction, and definitely for others.
Certainly, I totally agree with you on that. And Neha, I want to ask you, when you took over the command of this air defense unit, you would have had some perceptions, what it's going to be like. Did those perceptions square up with the reality? I mean, you're commanding a unit of 600 men.
See, Rahul, you know, the perceptions, you know, they don't build in one day. You know, they take time to build. And I have spent about 20 years in the army. And, you know, I understand the organization culture. I understand my duties, responsibilities. So perceptions as such, I don't think, you know, I would be commenting more on that. As far as the, you know, whether they squared up, yes, certainly. Because, you know, when I command my unit, I see it in the eyes of my men, my troops, my officers. You know, the kind of respect that they have given to me. And also, I see it in the achievements of my unit in administrative, training, and operational achievements, you know. So, yes, I can say it has squared up well, pretty well.
Well said. Anu, life on an ashore unit is vastly different from life on board a frontline warship. So when you were assigned to Kochi, one of the first women officers, was it a culture shock?
It was a, well, I have always been in operations. Initially, I am a naval air operation officer, so I have been flying with 1,000 hours of flying. So every time you go up in air, you have that period of intense adventure, excitement to accomplish a task. But once you are on board a ship, the tempo goes higher. You have anti-submarine exercise going up, the aircraft coming up, the flying is going on. So the tempo is built up for even longer. And I'm fortunate enough to have been appointed on board INS Kochi, the frontline destroyer, which has been actually awarded the best ship in Western Fleet recently. And
all right.
Thank you.
All right. Shaliza, what about you? How did you prepare yourself for this role? And I forgot to mention that Shaliza is also a helicopter pilot and a qualified flying instructor and quite a hard taskmaster. We'll talk about that later. And she's put in almost 3,000 hours of flying, which is not a small number. Shaliza, how did you prepare for the command role?
See, I think every role had its own challenges involved to it. Commanding a combat squadron has, you know, pride linked to it. So as a commanding officer, you know, everything is important, but more important is to prioritize them. You have to keep the morale of your men to the highest so that they are always ready to stand with you, whether irrespective of the time of the day. So in a nutshell, I'll say that whatever the role you are in, if you know what are the requirements, it is not that difficult to achieve them. You have to systematically plan them, you have to systematically choose them, and thereafter take everybody on board. You don't have to convince people because they are aware that being in uniform, what does it mean? So it was not really preparing for that role, because the day we, you know, wear this uniform, from the first day of our training, we have been trained in a very systematic manner.
Got it. You know, despite all the leaps women have made in the military, still all of us know they're vastly underrepresented in the armed forces. So if we see the numbers in the armed forces add up to about 1.5 million, and the lady cadre is just about 10,000, if my math serves me right, it's less than 1%. Not a very fair question, because you don't have women in the non-officer cadre yet. I mean, Navy's just started inducting. So how do you think we can correct this imbalance? Or in the last 6 to 7 years, the numbers have gone up from 4,000 to around 10,000. So, but how do you think can we correct this imbalance?
See, when we are dealing with the issue of national security, I feel it is unfair to talk about the numbers and the ratios and the percentage. I feel we should more talk about gender inclusivity, how women can be included in the armed forces and what roles they can play. Barring the three combat arms that women are not yet posted to, but rest all the other arms and services, women have been included by army quite well. And I think it is more to do with the inclusion rather than being the numbers.
Right, got it.
And our organization knows, they can and research what roles we will be better fitting into. So accordingly, I feel we shouldn't be talking about the
certainly a lot of clarity there, Neha. Anu, I come to you. We were talking about Agniveers before I cut you short earlier. Mm-hmm. And do you think the induction of women as Agniveers in the Navy, it's already happened, started this year, shortly happening in the Army, Air Force, do you think that will kind of help enhance the representation in the three services?
Definitely, Rahul. For example, Navy has now adopted the vision of all ranks for all roles for all ranks for all women. So now the Navy is having for all ranks, be that be officer cadre, be that be women's Agniveers who will be joining the ships shortly, all roles, all the branches of Navy is open. You can be a gunner, you can be a navigating officer, you can be a flyer, you can be anything that you want. So now that initially the girls who have not dreamt that they could actually do those things, now is open to them. So definitely I feel the numbers will go up exponentially, and there would be more representation of women in the armed forces.
Shaliza, what can be done to increase the appeal of armed forces among women?
See, I personally believe if you don't see just the number and we see the growth, where are we now vis-a-vis when we started the induction, I think we have grown a lot and we are still growing. As far as induction of women in defense forces are concerned, you already mentioned that Agniveer women are going to, you know, join us shortly, maybe another a month or so they will be with us. To know that there are defense forces, we require to reach to them, for which nowadays media is playing a big role. You know, earlier days, when I remember when I joined service, I didn't had much idea about Indian Air Force before I actually land up in an NCC unit, where I saw that, right, you know, there
so,
are...
Yeah. So you're talking about creating more awareness and, you know, the yes, opportunities they'll have in service. Right. So my next question is, you know, still, you know, parts of that combat exclusion policy, it's in fact more relevant to Army and the Navy, because Air Force has opened all roles to women. So Neha, whether it is infantry, mechanized infantry, armored corps, you don't have women officers or, you know, PBOR over there. Do you think women are ready for hardcore combat?
See, I'll put it this way. You know, the concept of war fighting, you know, it itself is going a huge change. You know, earlier we used to have, we basically talked about three dimensions of warfare, but now the dimension itself is changing. You know, we have space coming up, we have cyber, we have the information warfare. So in times to come, you know, the combat role as such will itself undergo, you know, a huge change, and women are likely to, you know, get more roles, get into more decision making, you know, apparatus, and probably they would be, you know, calling it a real combat happening. And we have seen it in the recent wars, you know, how these new dimensions, you know, they're coming up and playing a major role, you know, in the decisive war that's happening.
Anu, submarines are still off limits to women in the Navy.
Yes, Rahul, submarine branch, we have opened all the branches, especially in the combat role. If you say the warship is now open, warship is a frontline unit. But submarine, yes, it's not because women are not capable of it, but yes, because of the constraints of the spaces there. I am definitely sure, when I joined the Indian Navy, I never imagined myself to be posted on board a warship. But definitely, with times to come, I feel women will be there on board submarines as well.
Shaliza, now the eternal question and the eternal debate, which was traditionally used, or that logic was used to kind of keep women out of frontline duties. What if they are taken prisoners of war? You know, a lot of people say that when Abhinandan, that episode happened in Pakistan, what if there was a woman in the cockpit of that MiG-21 Bison? So what are your thoughts on that?
See, not to land up in that situation, we have been trained for that. If you land up in that situation, still we have been, you know, told what to do, or we have been trained to what activities or what all things we are supposed to do. And Group Captain Abhinandan has given the demo that what we are supposed to. So irrespective of the gender, it is the mindset of that individual at that particular time who is going to handle that situation. You cannot generalize based on the gender how a male officer or a male is going to respond when he is POW, or a woman who is going to be POW. It is just a defense officer or a defense personnel who is going to be there. So he or she will do what they get the training for and what they have prepared for the years.
Yeah, Abhinandan was absolutely very classy in the manner in which he handled the whole situation. Neha, what do you think? You know, if you remember Kargil, what happened to Nachiketa, Flight Lieutenant Nachiketa, what happened to Squadron Leader Ajay Ahuja, what happened to Captain Saurabh Kalia, the way they were tortured. What are your thoughts?
See, when a soldier is taken as a POW, the first responsibility is to escape, okay? And if at all he is captured, he or she is captured, you know, the next responsibility is not to reveal any information, any confidential information about the army. You know, we all understand, you know, there are Geneva conventions in place, you know, which talk about how the prisoner of war should be treated. But the history shows that, you know, they are subjected to the psychological and the physical torture. And if it comes to that, so be it, you know. Because I have joined the forces to defend my nation. And if I'm supposed to sacrifice my life, in whichever way, I'm ready for it.
Outstanding, outstanding. Anu, as an officer deployed on board a warship, you may not encounter that situation, but in your other role as an aircrew on a Dornier maritime surveillance aircraft, there is a likelihood, I mean, we're just talking about possibilities, of you or somebody like you landing up in that situation.
Yes, there can be a situation wherein you are flying close to our adversaries and you land up in that situation. Well, you are equipped, you have an aircrew knife, and the only thing I can say that if one lands up in that situation, one will fight to the very last breath. And if the situation arises that you are taken as prisoner of war, so be it. We have signed for it. We have taken an oath of allegiance to the Constitution of India, that be that the land, air, or at sea, we will fight to the peril of our life.
So you will use that aircrew knife against the enemy?
Definitely.
Okay. What about what about mindsets? For years, people talked about socio-cultural factors, physiological factors, psychological factors. When it came to assigning more roles to women, what do you think? Where does have those, you know, considering where you ladies are right now, have those ghosts been exorcised?
When I joined army about 2 decades back, I would say that socio-cultural issues were existing, you know, in some form, but now they are fading away slowly. As far as the physiological issues are concerned, you know, we are made differently, you know, we have to accept this fact. Biologically, women are different, you know, and there are few issues that come up. But over a period of time, we have learned the art of handling them, managing them.
What if you're asked to stay in a bunker with 6 soldiers along the border?
See, you know, now I'll ask you a question back.
What about a
woman doctor, you know, who's operating in a patient in a close confined space with other men? Or rather, the nurses who are supporting a gentleman doctor while operating a patient for hours together. So it is part of their job. Similarly, I have also joined up, you know, I have signed up for it. So if I have to be in the bunker with my men to defend my nation, I will be there.
Lovely. Shaliza, do you also think that the mindsets have been rewired now to an extent?
They have been. That's why probably 3 of us are sitting here. So definitely there has been a big change which had happened over 3 decades. And this change is very positively accepted by each and everybody who is there in the services. So definitely the change is there.
All right. So I won't say, have you encountered gender bias? I mean, this question is specifically to Neha because it's Army is the biggest service. Have you had those moments, you know, tumse na ho payega?
See, no, never. While I have been serving, you know, for so many years, I have never come across a gender bias, I would say. But as I talk about it, you know, there is this interesting episode in my life that, you know, I would like to mention. My CO had, you know, detailed me for an infantry weapon-oriented course. So I went there and I reported in the infantry school. And the officer in charge, he asked me, why have you come? So I told him, sir, I've been detailed by my CO to do this course. And he told me, no, women officers, they don't do this course. So please go back. I said, I'm not going to go back. After 2 hours, he accommodated me. And then the course started. You know, and throughout this, you know, month, it was a month-long course, somewhere or the other, he would mention this word called woman. Look at the woman. So, for instance, you know, I was firing and, you know, there was this grouping of, you know, the rounds that we fire. And it was a fair group.
By grouping, she means where they hit the target,
where they hit
right?
the target. So, and, you know, it was a fair group. It was like 4 to 5 centimeters. And I think I did well. But it was little off the center point. And, you know, which could have been corrected, you know, in the next round. But, you know, he made a kind of mockery of it and said, look at the, you know, grouping of a woman officer. And I didn't know like that. And another instance, you know, when we were practicing, we were rehearsing the drills for road opening party and the convoy protection and the quick reaction team. And he would, you know, intentionally mention, okay, let's see how a woman officer does it. So somehow I felt that, you know, he shouldn't be doing this all the time. But when the course got over and, you know, this gentleman, he came to me and he told me, you know, Neha, I was pushing you intentionally, you know, beyond your limits. And, you know, being an infantry officer, I have never come across a woman officer. And you have changed my opinion for the rest of my life. And then, because I was awarded one of the best grades in that course, I was the first woman officer to get that. And, you know, he walked into the hall and there were the rest of the, you know, course mates were sitting. There were 60 of them. And he asked them, any one of you who feels that Neha doesn't deserve to get this grade? And, you know, they all echoed, you know, together that, no, sir, she very much deserves it. So, you know, so why I gave this story, you know, sometimes the gender bias, you know, it is in our perception, you know, they don't really exist. So we should, you know, be a little more clear and, you know, give it some more time when we form our own opinions about people, you know, how they're treating you. So personally, no gender bias at all.
So we're almost running out of time. Very quick question to all, so actually to Shaliza and Neha, not to young Annu because she's not in a command role yet. What's your secret sauce for leadership, and what can the audience over here and people who are watching you take home from your leadership experience, to both of you?
I'll say, to command a unit, you need to connect to the last person. You need to know the morale of your squadron. As a commanding officer, you don't only look after or overlook or, I mean, do the only the operational thing. You have to look up the operational capability. You want your combat flight to always be in a combat ready position. You want administration to be strong enough, morale of your men to be strong enough so that they are with you. The maintenance of that equipment, that need to be there. So as a commanding officer, it's not only one, you know, corridor which you have to look, you have to look another corridors so that you combine them all together and take the things to the higher level. So that every time you're combat ready, whatever role has been given to you, you're able to finish that role within the time frame. So prioritization of tasks, knowing that what is the time frame for that particular thing and what are the requirement of that role.
Right.
So that is
Neha, very quickly, very quickly.
You know, Rahul, in my office, on my table, I have put this quote, God, make me worthy, you know, of the men that I command. I see that quote every day and I inspire myself. And talking about the, you know, leadership, integrity towards the organization, truthfulness towards the job, the responsibility, my duties, and compassion for my men. These are my secrets of leadership.
Great, great. Excellent. I wish we had more time, but I think we'll have to wrap it up. But before we wrap it up, I hope in the years to come, we see you with more stars and stripes on your shoulders, and hope to have you back at the Leadership Summit. And ladies and gentlemen, give it up for the panel. Bold, brave, beyond barriers.